discernment. There is a more knowing part inside us that actually the feelings are expressors of that knowing. And those feelings, when we pay attention to them, they can guide us in the direction we need to go.
Cure this world's disease. stars. Though peace is pure and real, so pain is true. We must endure to feel. What else can we do? I've no desire for what this fighting is for. We can't fight fire with fire, nor war with war. The antidote to terror lies in peace. Only love can cure this world's disease. Only love can cure this world's disease.
Good morning, and please be welcome once again to our Unity Online experience. I am Reverend Anna Quintana, the Associate Minister here at Unity of the Triangle, and I'm here next to Reverend Neusom Holmes, our Senior Minister. How do you like that formal presentation?
It doesn't fit with today's talk.
Tell us, we're still fully into the series on the Wizard of Oz.
Yes.
But tell us more, what are we doing today?
Well, today we're going to be talking about the strength of feeling your own feelings and the power of compassion.
Which is something that I believe that this spiritual community is known for. We do a lot of heart meditations. We like to really develop that aspect of ourselves, which is really the doorway to our full divine nature, and I'm really looking forward to another good talk on how we can be fully anchored there and live life from that space. So,
and Anna, I think that's something you do really well. Is you're very in touch with the emotive and feeling state of your being, and you bring that to other people, and they love you for it.
So it's like the song says, feelings. Anyways, Talk about feeling, talk about prayer, talk about love. Let's bring our pastoral care minister, Mimi Lowe Miller, who will lead us into another beautiful prayer to pray over our prayer requests, intentions, and intentions.
Prayer is foundational to unity for all Unity churches. It's one of our fifth principles. We have volunteers who are willing to pray with you or for you. So to submit a prayer request, go online or put your name in this prayer box. So now let's pray over the names in this prayer box. We drop our attention into the sacred sanctuary of the heart, where we feel the presence of the divine. We cannot know the divine through the intellect of the mind. We can only know God through the feeling state of the heart. When we anchor into our spiritual heart, we come home to our core essence, the divinity within us. We affirm each of us, including every name in this prayer box, is held tenderly in the arms of spirit, like a mother cradling a child, as the abounding love from God flows through us, we feel comforted and protected by a power greater than ourselves. Our loving hearts exude enthusiastic joy, and our broken hearts provide an opportunity for us to expand our compassion, kindness, and empathy for others. Feeling peaceful and full of grace, our hearts sing a sacred song from spirit filled with gratitude and love. And so we rest. Amen.
Taking ourselves into meditation, let's adjust the body, become relaxed and yet alert. Let's let the body find a comfortable way to sit so that there is less discomfort and more consciousness available to exploration. So sit comfortably. And breathe deeply. Now, I'd like to point out to you that there are ribs that go way down in the back. And so when you breathe deeply, allow your breath to go all the way down the back as far and as deep as the ribs go. And let the belly extend as you breathe deeply, pulling the air more thoroughly down into the lungs. And then when we exhale, let us do that slowly and gracefully. The breath not only brings us oxygen, but it also calms the mind when we focus on it. And as you breathe, allow your sense of self to extend beyond the body. Get a sense that you and your energy are bigger than the body. Awaken the intuition by bringing some energy to the forehead. And awaken the divine, its connection to you, and the flow of energy between the two of you by paying attention to the crown of your head and imagining pure white light, the light of God, pouring into your head, filling your whole being. And awaken the throat that you might feel yourself in a place of power where you can declare a thing and make it so. Finally, let us open our hearts. and extend from your heart out into this whole field that you are, that extends beyond the body, a radiance of love and acceptance. And with a silent but powerful voice, say, I extend love into this world. And with your intuition, see how far you can send it. And drawing upon the divine love, let it be the force that moves love out from you, so that it is not just you, but the divine flowing through you. And let your love extend in all directions. Before you, behind you, above you, below you. And you become a beacon of love in this world. And this love, coupled with your strength, that you can declare and heal and invite all good things to you, and declare and heal and invite all good things to everyone else. Let this be a time of generosity and grace. And let there be peace on earth as it begins with us, as we sit together in holy silence. As we continue our discussion of The Wizard of Oz, I want to remind you that last week, Dorothy, kind of against her own will, was invited to go on an adventure. And she left Kansas and went to Oz. And she was all alone, but soon she meets a whole crowd of people, and they tell her to take the Yellow Brick Road. As she takes the Yellow Brick Road, almost immediately, she begins to add characters to her retinue of people, of just, instead of just being her, she becomes one of four creatures moving on to the land of Oz. And as they go down the Yellow Brick Road, the first one she meets is the Scarecrow. Now, the Scarecrow is stuck up on a pole, and he can't move around. He can't get even scare the crows that are there. But so he's really stuck. And as he speaks with Dorothy, she decides to invite him to come with her. And she takes him down off the pole, and his desire is to have a brain. His cloth head is stuffed with straw. It's not enough for him. And he wants to be able to think, and he has a grand idea of what thinking must be like, and it's something he really wants. So he wants a brain. And the next person she meets is the Tin Man. And the Tin Man is frozen. He can't move. He can barely mumble something, and they oil him, and he becomes mobile, and he tells them he wants a heart because he's hollow inside and cannot feel. Now, these two characters join with the lion, which we'll talk about next week, but these two characters, interestingly, are really good at saying they don't have. They believe very honestly in their hearts, well, if they had one, they believe that they don't have the qualities that they would like, the qualities that would make them more complete, a brain or a heart, to be able to think or to feel. And so their desire is to meet the wizard and the wizard to give them a brain or a heart so they could think or feel. As adventures unfold, of course, you'll see that the smartest one of them really is the Scarecrow. He comes up with all the good ideas, and it turns out that becomes his real forte. He's a good thinker and planner. And the Tin Man is the one who has the most emotions. He almost cries himself into rusting again. It is the very thing that they think they lack that they are actually demonstrating in the movie. And so I'd like for us to consider our own way of doing this very same thing. How many times has it been that you think you don't know the answer to something? You feel as though it's just it's a mystery to you what you should do next, or what the conclusion of your efforts will be, or where you should go. And I think one of the things we have trained ourselves to do is to feel less smart, less intuitive, less wise than we really are. Certainly at times when friends have asked us something, we know what they should do right away. We're very good at telling them. And as it turns out, sometimes we're actually right. If we use that same willingness to declare what is the right thing for us to do or for the as we do for other people, I think we might see that deep inside us, there's some compass, some knowing, some automatic yes, no, more like this, less like that aspect of ourselves, which is guiding us on our path of unfolding. And we often don't pay attention to it. Sometimes it's external things that will be telling us, no, don't go that way. No, don't go that way. And yet we determinedly or habitually go that way. I want to tell you a little story about me. I heard from a realtor that he had three properties that looked like would pay me very well if I invested in them. And I went about trying to get loans for all three properties. And the owner herself was not very agreeable. And every time I did something for the to qualify for the loan, they would ask for something more. This is pretty common now, but it got really ridiculous and it got to be so irritating. And I found myself extremely angry and frustrated that this was taking so long and taking so much of my time. And I continued to feel like a criminal in applying for these loans. Now, I just did one recently, and so it went very differently. So I know it doesn't have to be this way, but that's how I felt then. And in many ways, these were screaming at me to reconsider the idea that I buy these properties. I went ahead and bought the properties, and they turned out to go from instant success and cash flow that I thought was coming to me to a negative. They took more time, they took more money, they probably never produced anything, one-tenth of what I thought they were, and they, in the end, caused me so much aggravation. There were clues along the way. If I had listened inside, I would have said, you know, I really don't like these places. Why am I buying them? But I was intent on an idea that I might get something more than I put into it. It turned out it was just the opposite. So I think there are clues that come to us, both internally, the way I felt, and externally, the hoops I was being put before me, that should have been indicators that perhaps I wasn't really on the yellow brick road. I was on some dirt path to nowhere. And the same thing can be true said that sometimes it is the very feeling that we have that can be our guiding force. And I think in many ways, this can be a little bit tricky. And I say that because sometimes our feelings are based on decisions that we have made repeatedly that have caused us to have automatic responses to certain stimulus. And so our feelings can be off by quite a bit. But there is, if we learn to discern this, there is a more knowing part inside us that actually the feelings are expressors of that knowing. And those feelings, when we pay attention to them, they can guide us in the direction we need to go. You can walk into a room and go, you know, there's something not right here. I think I better go someplace else. You can meet someone and know instantly if you like them or not, and if you find them to be dangerous or not. The very act of paying attention to our inner state is really a large part of what we gain by being in meditation and in silence, is we become attuned to this body and mind structure, which somehow knows more than our conscious mind might give it credit for. And so if we can pay attention to our inner feelings, I think we begin to become more adept at moving through the world, making wiser decisions, and letting ourselves be guided by something higher than our simple way of thinking. And so the tin man wants a heart. And yet it turns out that when he gets to the Wizard of Oz says, you know, you already have it. You've already demonstrated it. And the same with the scarecrow. He says, I'll just give you a diploma to prove you have the intelligence. You think about it. Sometimes all we need is confirmation from the outside to encourage us that we are wise or we have feelings and that we really care. I think that's why community becomes so important on the spiritual path. There's so many ways to doubt ourselves when we're in this life. We can doubt ourselves as being smart enough or having enough depth that we don't know what we think or feel. We can wonder. But sometimes in conversation, merely having someone else reflect back to us what we've been doing or feeling, that we can take encouragement from their presence, their way of affirming that we're on the path, that somehow we haven't lost it. I think over this last year of the pandemic, many of us have spent so much time alone, One of the things I've noticed has come out of this is that we're a little more reticent to actually be with people, and it's taking a while for us to open up to them. And so in some ways, not only has the pandemic been a time of isolation, but even the present, we're not quite into the flow of it. We don't feel like we know what's going on. And that's why I think it's really helpful if you can have some friends to help pull you out, to help you remember who you are, that you're a wise person, that you're a loving person, that when you come together with other people, you have things to share with them and they have things to share with you. And this sharing is part of what it is to be a human being. For most of our existence as creatures on this earth, we have been social animals. And as social animals, we need their interaction. And so when we get a chance to interact with people in a way that feels safe to us, I think it begins to open up avenues of knowing inside ourselves. We're reminded by them that, hey, you know, we do have good ideas, or yes, we really do care for people. If you really wanted to develop your mind, though, and to develop your heart, I think few ways could be as helpful as being compassionate with others. This idea of compassion really kind of combines the whole idea of wisdom and of caring. And when we do compassion, one of the things we often need to bring to it is a sense of understanding. Sometimes that is just so that we can move into the state of compassion. We need to understand that they're what has brought the person to the place where they are. We can, using our imagination, sometimes create a story that allows us to feel empathy for the situation they're in. You often see people on the side of the road these days with signs that say, "Can you help?" or "Anything will be of value to me. Please, I'm a veteran," or something like that. One of the things I've noticed, and I think somewhat amplified in the last year, is that people are beginning to know what it's like to feel isolated and to be alone. So when we see people on the side of the road asking for money, we realize that they're real people and that there but by the grace of God go I. And likewise, we have hopefully begun to realize that some of the ways that people have bought into ideas that seem so outrageous to us, or have begun to believe untruths that have been promulgated, we can develop compassion for them because we know what it's like to want to know answers and to feel like the world is not on our side. We know what that's like, what that feels like, because at times in our life we have had that. And our wisdom is to recognize those feelings which we have had. Perhaps those are the ones that are guiding other people. And if we're in touch with our feelings, if we begin to feel our feelings, then it helps us to have compassion for someone else and to build an understanding, even if it's imagined, an understanding of why someone might be where they are. And with this compassion, we also recognize that our bodies are feeling mechanisms, that they feel things, they add to a richness of our life, the richness of suffering, but also the richness of joy, happiness, and the expression of companionship. These are things that the body can know. And when we practice compassion, we deepen our ability to sense within ourselves our own feeling states. And maybe we need to be reminded that as we love, we feel that love first. As we care for another, we feel a sense of belonging like we wouldn't have otherwise. Our whole being reflects the way we extend out. It reflects back to us first. So if we're loving and compassionate to the world or to any one person, we find that what comes back to us is that feeling of love and compassion toward ourselves. We have essentially a mirror in front of us when we see someone. And as we give it to them, it comes bouncing back to us. So if we wish to develop wisdom and deeper sense of feelings, I think the growth of compassion in our being is a beautiful way of doing it. It also has this other aspect, which might lead us to act in such a way that it becomes a benefit for others. Our world, our society, easily makes it possible for us to focus only on ourselves. It's very much a me, me, me kind of place. And if we do that, it's possible for us to get all our ducks in a row, for us to have the car, the house, the things in just as we like them. It's possible to do that. But in the end, I don't think it's perfectly satisfying. It's really much more satisfying when we can use some of what we have, some of the prosperity that we experience, some of the wisdom, some of the skills we have, some of the time or the talent we have. As we give it away to someone else, we realize that we're in a bigger world, and a world in which we belong, a world in which we are loved and cared for because we have extended loving and caring to others. It's more likely to come back to us from them, but it's also very much more likely to radiate from within us and us to feel it. So, as Forrest Gump would say, stupid is as stupid does. Loving is as loving does. Wisdom is as wisdom does. Let us not be afraid to be our true selves. Let us practice compassion and know that we are big enough to handle the world as we see it when we open our hearts and we give of ourselves wisely to the situations and the people in front of us. Let us join with other people who are doing this world with compassion and see if we can't create a world that we would think the Wizard of Oz would give us. A beautiful world, a world of full life, full joy, full happiness. Our hearts and minds long to be used. Let us use them in the service of compassion and be that light unto the world we have always wanted to be. May your journey to the center of your being be one of grace and ease. And from that center, may you express the gifts that you have, the gifts of wisdom and love. And so it is. Amen.
Notice how she would grin at the church in. And if a tear came to my eye, think of all the wounds they mend, and just to think the time I could spend being vulnerable again. Tell me what would I do? What would I do? What would I do if I could feel? If I could feel? If I could feel?
So we're back here once again. Neusom, thank you so much for bringing your gift to the world and to our community. And to those of you who might be the first time that you're tuning in, you might wonder, who are we and what our mission is? And I'm being guided to share that with you at this moment. And to those of you who are regular members here, it's excellent to be reminded of what we stand for, what we're here for. And our mission statement reads, we are, you want us to repeat it with me?
I would love to.
Okay.
We are a spiritual community awakening to our divine nature through love, service, and personal transformation.
So if you're in alignment, like I'm sure you are, with our mission, we highly encourage you to support our spiritual community. And right now, Neusom, you might want to just let them know the different options that we have, especially the automatic giving.
Well, we have a lot of options, and we are emphasizing automatic giving, which you can do through the website, because we have automatic bills. And so we're hoping that this spiritual community can be supported automatically through the gifts of many of our members who wish to just see this go on and on.
And we certainly don't take for granted your generosity. We know, because we know of our people and how committed they are to our mission, that these donations or love offerings come from a really space of gratitude, love, and even joy. So please do that at this moment. Open up in gratitude, be in joy, and give from that place, which is the place of the heart, which is essentially what our talk was today.
So let's say our blessing we do each week together.
Divine love through me blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. And we would like to let everybody know that this series will culminate on our building anniversary weekend, August 15th.
Right, and we'll have a movie on that Friday night before the Sunday. The big celebration will be in person here at the church that we built and moved into 5 years ago.
So mark your calendar, Friday the 13th, we're gonna have the Wizard of movie and as a community. And then on Sunday the 15th will be a special service followed by a really nice lunch. I think we're done for
today. I
think
we did. So let us just say,
we love you.
We bless you.
We appreciate you.
And we behold the Christ in you.
Have a wonderful week and see you soon.
Namaste.
The light of God surrounds us.
I am the light of God.
The love of God enfolds us.
I am the love of God.
The power of God protects us.
I am the power of God.
And the presence of God watches over us.
I am the presence of God.
Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. Thank you.